The other day, while I was skimming through a semiconductor physics book, I came across an idea. Theoretically, you should be able to change the color of an LED using heat. But before trying right away if it is true, we need to understand first how an LED works and what does temperature have to do with the color. So join me in this quick review of LED physics. I think that everyone here knows that LED stands for light emitting diode. And the word we need to highlight is diode. So we'll start with a little review of band diagrams, since, as you'll see, they are fundamental to explain the LED working principle. Semiconductors on the energy level can be thought of as having two bands. The lower energy one is called valence band, in which most of the electrons are, while the higher one is called conduction band, which instead is almost empty. The middle part is called band gap. Electrons are not allowed to have an energy that is in the band gap, that's why it is also known as forbidden band. As an example, the band gap energy level for silicon is 1.14 electron volts. The distribution of electrons in the valence band and the conduction band is governed by the Fermi-Dirac distribution, that at the absolute zero temperature looks like this. Having no energy, all the electrons will be in the valence band, while the conduction band is completely empty. The Fermi level represents the 50% point of the Fermi distribution. If the temperature increases, the distribution will start to look like that. Some electrons will gain enough energy from thermal excitation to cross the forbidden band and go into the conduction band, where they are free to move. They are now called free carriers. If you look closely, you'll see that this left some vacancies in the valence band where electrons used to be. The neighbor electrons are free to move by filling those vacancies. This can be thought as the motion of the vacancy itself, and that's what we call an hole, which is an imaginary particle that represents an electron vacancy. In the same way, holes are free to move, so we can ditch representing all the electrons in the valence band and just use the free moving hole. If we use a doped semiconductor, things change a little. In a p-type semiconductor, the Fermi level will move near the valence band edge. So we'll have lots of free holes there and no electrons in the conduction band. That's why majority carriers in a p-type semiconductor are holes. In the same way, in an n-type semiconductor, we'll have lots of free electrons and no holes. Let's consider now a p-type region and an n-type region. The band diagrams will look something like this. If we connect the two regions, we'll create a p-n junction, aka a diode. How do we join the band diagrams? We need to consider one thing. The Fermi level, from the definition itself, must be a constant in the whole material, at least in equilibrium. So in order to join the two band diagrams, we'll need to shift them so that both Fermi levels are aligned. In the middle region, we'll have what's called band bending. That is, the bands must curve in order to get back connected together. This region is called depletion region, and this is what creates the barrier potential in the diode. Electrons in an n-type region would like to diffuse to the p-type region, and similarly the holes from the p-type to the n-type. However, the potential barrier prevents it. If we apply a forward bias, the bands will shift and the barrier lowers. Now, both electrons and holes are free to diffuse toward the opposite region. Here we see the carriers fade away, but where do they go? Well, consider an electron reaching the p-type region. That one is quite an happy particle. The p-type region is full of vacancies that can be filled by the electron. So the electron has nothing left to do but choose where to go. So it will fill one of the vacancies in an event that is called recombination. An electron-hole pair gets annihilated. Let's see the same thing in the band diagram representation. So we lost a hole in the p-type region. Luckily, it gets replenished by the battery providing the forward bias. The same exact thing happens for the holes reaching the n-type region, and in this way an electrical current is created. Now, if we look closely at this recombination event, we can see that the electron, by recombining, loses some energy. But where does this energy go? The excess energy gets emitted as a photon, in what's called radiative recombination. You can think of photons as the particles of light. Weird, I know, but this is a result of quantum mechanics, so I won't really further elaborate, just particles of light, okay? The energy of this particle is trivially equal to the one lost from the electron, that is the bandgap energy. The photon energy can be also expressed like this, where h is the Planck's constant and ni is the frequency. And since the frequency is equal to c over lambda, where c is the speed of light and lambda is the wavelength, we can finally obtain the wavelength of the emitted light, which is nothing more than the color. Unfortunately, the emitted light is more like a spectrum of colors instead of a single frequency, since, if you recall what we say at the beginning, electrons and holes are mostly near the band edge, but following the Fermi distribution we could have more energetic electrons or holes recombining, giving out photons with higher energies. So we finally created some light from our PN junction. Unfortunately, not all recombination events are radiative. One simple example is the so-called Auger recombination, in which the excess energy, instead of being emitted as a photon, is given to another electron in the conduction band. Another example is trap-assisted recombination. Defects or impurities in the material can lead to some allowed energy states in the bandgap, called traps. Thus, carrier can recombine by falling into the traps and then falling in the valence band. And this kind of recombination is non-radiative. The probability of having a radiative or non-radiative recombination is material dependent, and unfortunately for LED manufacturers, silicon has an extremely low probability of radiative recombination. That's why you don't see your normal diodes glowing in the dark. Another important non-radiative recombination event is surface recombination. A surface is quite problematic for a semiconductor since it interrupts the periodicity of the crystal, creating atoms, dangling bonds, and other asymmetries. This results in the creation of a lot of trapped states in the bandgap. So if an electron reaches the end of the P region without recombining, there is a high probability that it will recombine non-radiatively through these surface states. Why is it a problem? Can't we just make the p-type region longer to be sure it won't happen? Unfortunately, not really. Let's look at the physical structure of an LED. When a photon is generated, if the p-region is too long, there is a possibility for the photon to get reabsorbed into the semiconductor. In fact, as a recombination event can generate a photon, the inverse thing can happen as well. A photon can hit an electron in the valence band, thus getting absorbed and exciting the electron in the conduction band. So we need to make the P region small. But by making it smaller, we increase the probability of the electron reaching the surface and recombining through the surface states with no photon emission. That's why homojunction, that is a junction between the same material, are rarely used for LEDs. We need to create an heterojunction by joining two different materials with different bandgap energies. In this way, if we look at the Venn diagram, a well is created at the junction. Electrons and holes then, under forward bias, will get trapped in the well, avoiding the risk of them reaching the surface. So we increase the probability of radiative recombination to happen in that well. At this point, you should have clear in mind how an LED works, or sort of. So we can get back to the original question. Can we change its color with heat? You should remember that the energy of the photon, which is related to wavelength, that is, the color, by this relation, is mostly given by the energy of the bandgap. However, the bandgap has a quite interesting temperature dependence given by the Varshnis equation, where EG0, alpha and beta are material-dependent parameters. So at this point, everything should be clear. If we increase the temperature, the bandgap energy will decrease. Thus, the emitted photons will have a lower energy, so a longer wavelength. Now, the hard question, is this bandgap temperature dependence strong enough to see a real color variation or not? And the answer is, I don't know. We'd need to know first the material of the LED we're going to use, which is usually not a given information, to have the correct EG0, alpha and beta. And even if we knew the material, different molar fractions of the single elements could have been used, and that would obviously change all the parameters. However, we can do a very rough estimation. Let's take a random material commonly utilized in LEDs, gallium phosphide. A quick search on Google will tell us the parameters we need. Gallium phosphide is usually mixed with other elements to manufacture LEDs, like in aluminum gallium phosphide for green LEDs. However, I couldn't really find any parameter for that, so we'll just use gallium phosphide as our very rough first estimation. We can then plot the wavelength with respect to temperature. You can see here how starting from room temperature, 300 Kelvin, going up to 900 Kelvin, there is a very meaningful shift of color from green to red. Now, 900 Kelvin isn't something we're going to be able to achieve in a home experiment, so it is time to show you our little experimental setup. So the idea is the following. We'll use two 5 watts 100 ohm power resistors. We'll apply 30 volts, and this should give us a dissipated power of approximately 18 watts, generating a lot of heat. Our LED under test will be sandwiched between the resistors. If we knew the thermal resistance of the resistors, we could theoretically compute the temperature increase. However, we don't. So we'll hope that will be enough. And here's the real thing. Quite ugly to look at, but it should work. The only thing I have to try to measure the temperature of this thing is a meat thermometer. So if we turn on the power supply, you can see how in less than a couple of minutes, it goes well over the maximum of 120 Celsius degrees, or 250 Fahrenheit. So I think we could be quite positive that this thing should reach something in the range of 200 to 250 Celsius degrees, given enough time. Now, how do we power up our LED? A simple resistor could do, however, we need to take into consideration one important thing. That is, for the same reasons explained above, the temperature increase leads to a reduction of the voltage drop of the diode. So, while we increase the temperature with our thing, the voltage drop decreases, the current will increase as well. And in the extreme case, the increased current could heat up even more the LED, leading to failure. Now, this shouldn't really affect the LED color, but we'd like to avoid destroying it before being able to appreciate the color change. So, to avoid that, we use this very simple circuit here. This is simply a constant current sink that will sink a constant current from our LED. The current value will be the base meter voltage of Q1 divided by R1. So we'll be sure that the same current crosses the LED even when the voltage drop will decrease. We are finally all set, so we can start the experiment. We'll use a yellow LED, so we'd expect a color shift toward the orange color or even red if we are lucky enough. Unfortunately, this is the only light condition in which the camera could catch the yellow color of the LED. So, let's turn on the power supply and see what happens. We can see how the color is quite quickly changing to an orange-like color. After 6 minutes, even if hard to catch through the camera, the color has turned to a beautiful cherry red. We can see it even better if we compare this frame with the initial one at room temperature. If we turn off the lights, you can really appreciate the difference. We can then turn off the resistor's power supply and see how, very slowly, the color starts to change back to orange and again toward yellow. At this point, I think we can be quite satisfied with the results. What about other colors? What would happen with a red LED? Well, if the temperature dependence is strong enough, we would see the light slowly fading away, since red is in the upper spectrum of visible light, and by increasing even more the wavelength, we would go into the infrared spectrum, which is not visible to the naked eye. Concluding, if you think about it, you might have already seen these effects by yourself without realizing it. What happens when you forget to use a resistor with LEDs or use a too low resistance? A lot of current will pass through it, heating up the junction. And that's why you see yellow LEDs turning red or green ones turning orange before reaching the failure temperature and letting the magic smoke out.